Thank you all for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. I was introduced to MI2 by, I'm recently a member of the Innovation Learning Network, ILN. So I haven't been to any of the meetings, so I just joined recently, so it's a pleasure to be here. I was in DC for other meetings. I had to be able to stop by and meet some of the great folks here. So just talk very briefly, in 15, 20 minutes, about some of the work that we're doing at Sinai, and also at some of my previous work at Walgreens, where I was for a number of years, trying to transform healthcare. And I actually ran the telehealth program there too, so I know that space very well. So at Walgreens, you know, everybody knows them as a large pharmacy, and so their intent was to move away from just being a pharmacy and a retail provider. And the challenge is, the blessing and the curse of Walgreens, I always say, it's a 100-year-old company that I could get access to anybody I wanted to. They saw 6 million people a day throughout their 8,000-plus locations. So great, great access to patients across the country in very convenient locations and a great brand. But the problem was it's a 100-year-old pharmacy and retailer. So for them to do other things like telehealth or other programs, it was certainly very different from their DNA. They're really good at opening new stores. That's where their comfort was. That's really where their core competency was. But innovation in healthcare is something that was challenging. One of the interesting things that we did, though, was we launched a venture fund, about a $200 million fund in 2011. So I was one of the key members of that. So it was part of our way to grow into innovative spaces. We thought we might as well co-invest. If we're going to help some startup scale, why not take a part of the action ourselves? So that was the rationale. We invested in both venture firms, which is really easy, write a number of big checks, it makes it pretty straightforward, but investing in small Series A or Series B companies is a lot more work, a lot more diligence. And I guess a couple of key learnings there that I found, in terms of, because I wasn't in that space before, one is to have a dedicated team. I was doing this along with a number of other things, kind of on a part-time basis, along with some other folks, and it frankly does require a lot more full-time commitment. Number two, I would say, is it's really important to understand the rationale for why you're making investments. So, even though $200 million is a pretty good size for a corporate fund, it doesn't move the needle for a $70 billion company. The answer is it really for a return on investment, which might or might not be the best thing, because we're not professional venture folks that look at this 12 hours a day, or B, is it strategic? So how can we leverage it within the assets? But the challenge is that on the strategy side, that really implies that your business unit really has to own it and implement it. And that's very hard to do. Big companies, as we all know, health systems too, are really good at doing things that they're comfortable doing. In health systems, patient care, Walgreens was selling retail items or dispensing medications. So, it's hard to be a corporate venture guy because, at the end of the day, you're reliant on the business to really own it, to operate it, to manage it, to implement it. And that takes resources, that takes time. And if things are small, like telehealth is a great example, we can move the needle, 10, 20 patients a day. People are like, well, that's not going to move my needle. That's even though it's really innovative and it would really drive patient care and it's great from a PR perspective, it didn't move the needle. So it's very hard to get stuff done. So I guess the point is, have a very good plan as to why you're in that space. It was extremely exciting. I learned a lot, met a lot of great companies and a number of great entrepreneurs, and I have a lot more respect now for folks that are trying to start their own companies now, because I know hard it is to work with people like us, because we're fickle, right? We change our minds every day, every quarter, every year. We don't commit the resources that we say we will, so we're decent at writing checks, but beyond that, it's hard to execute with guys like big companies. I think health systems are included. So those were a couple of lessons I learned while I was there. Overall, a very great experience, and I learned a tremendous deal trying to move the needle in healthcare at a company like that. Talk a little bit more about my current role. So I've been at Sinai about 8 months now, so very new here. So I left Walgreens to become the Chief Strategy Officer of Sinai, which is about almost 100 years old as well, so a very well-known entity in Chicago, one of the four level one trauma centers in Chicago, serving the south and west sides of town.
Down or over should work.
Right? The arrows down is not working.
Okay. Oh, yes.
Maybe that's it.
Can you comment on the, I know Walgreens is putting in doctors in a retail doctors in some of the Walgreens?
Yeah, they have, you know, different models. I mean, they've got about 400 take-care clinics, which are mostly nurse practitioner-led.
Yeah.
And so they are potentially looking at doctors. They actually have some at Duane Reade in New York.
Right.
They do have some already there. That's a challenging business model, though, in general. Retail health, I know we're all talking about retail health care, but it's just the sheer volume to make break even is tough in that space. And doctors are obviously more expensive than nurse practitioners. So,
are the pharmacies putting it in to drive ancillary purchases, or is it,
you know,
or just to make money on their or just to,
you
know, deliver the service?
You really need the other stuff to make the economics work. You need both script lift as well as you know, other ancillary products to make it work. Just the actual clinical aspect alone typically doesn't drive it. The problem is you need, let's say, 20 to break even. If you get 30, your patient experience suffers. You need another practitioner, which doubles your fixed cost. So then you're chasing your tail to try to provide the best service, you know, without an appointment. But you don't want too many, because then your people are waiting too long for service, and they're going to leave.
Right.
And so it's a challenge. So Monday mornings are busy, but you know, Tuesday afternoon might not be, right? So that's the challenge in that space. But you know, that's where the world's moving with high deductible health plans. I mean, and a lot of things can be solved by nurse practitioners or through telehealth. And so I think there's a huge opportunity. And the nice thing is the younger generations, that's what they expect, and that's what they're comfortable with. So I think that the timing is good now. I've been talking about this for years, and it wasn't the right time for a long time. So, but yeah, no,
that's
another example at Walgreens that we're doing is, that they were doing, I'm not there anymore, is Theranos, which is a lab company. You guys might have heard about them.
Mm-hmm.
They are an innovative lab company out of Palo Alto that is really producing hundreds of lab tests at a fraction of the amount of blood needed, and actually at half of Medicare rates, right? So if you're a state with financial difficulty, and I know Illinois is in that space, if I can cut my lab costs in half with the same quality, boy, I'm gonna flock to it. Now it's a different, and it's a better user experience. You can go to a Walgreens right now. You can go to 30 of them in the Arizona area and actually get this test done, as opposed to going to a lab or a Quest. And the patient experience isn't frankly great those places. I've had to go for them for drug screens or whatever for different jobs. It's not fun. It takes a long time. There, you know, there's a lot of sick people waiting there. And
so Theranos is a drop of blood, and
yeah,
it gives you a whole panel of results.
Yeah. It's amazing.
This is so interesting. Some people think this is gonna completely transform.
It might disrupt.
I was actually having my blood drawn. I was talking to one of his lab techs who had been there for a long time. And we both remarked on a innovation, sort of like Theranos, but this was many, many years ago, that also completely transformed, which was, and all of you have experienced it, many of you have never been in a pre-state, which is the vacutainer. The vacuum, plugging it in, completely closed system. The blood comes into the tube because of the suction. And prior to the vacutainer, you had to have a syringe and a needle. Warren's nodding his head. Right? Messy.
Makes me old.
Yeah, it does indeed. and it was messy and risky. And it's one of those examples of how great innovation, exponential adoption curve. And it just took off. And I have a hunch. A lot of people have a hunch that Theranos is...
Well, they're a $9 billion valued company right now, which is crazy. They're, you know, the CEO was on the cover of Fortune not long ago. So interesting story if you guys want to read about healthcare innovation or disruption. I mean, there's no better example than that, I think, in the current market. So Walgreens was an investor in that as well. So something that, you know, I've got some familiarity with. We'll see.
She was a Stanford student who took 10 years off, evidently.
She was like a sophomore, I think.
Yeah.
It's a sophomore, you know, like, amazing story. You know, very impressive woman. Very bright, obviously. So anyway, let's talk a little bit about Sinai. We're four hospitals. The main campus is Mount Sinai, which is the flagship. And about 2 years ago, they acquired Holy Cross, which is on the south side down here. So as you can see, it's all on the south and west sides of Chicago. The part that makes us a bit innovative and unique is the fact that we have two non-clinical entities. One is the Sinai Community Institute, and the other is the Sinai Urban Health Institute. The Sinai Urban Health Institute, we have about 35 epidemiologists full-time on staff studying different things around healthcare. So that's a big number, and we actually have very well published nationwide, and we actually even sell some of our work to our models to other health systems, like community health workers. How do we use them? And we've been doing it for 20 years before it became popular. And we have specific programs around asthma, diabetes, obesity, with actual clinicians that actually go out in the community and actually are, you know, knocking on doors, literally, to really improve the health of those folks. You know, in our community. We have 16 different medical groups, I mean practices. So we have 41 specialties. We're largely a specialty hospital, not so much primary care. We get most of our primary care from FQHCs, which dominate the Chicago market.
What do you say what those are?
Federally Qualified Health Centers. So the federal government has taken an active stance in helping promote primary care, particularly in these are lower income areas where there is a lack of them. And so they subsidize them to some degree, better reimbursement. They don't have to pay as much medical malpractice insurance. It's a better deal for the community to have FQHCs in the area. So we don't have our own large primary care network. I know you guys can't read this, but there's a little bit more about about the different the seven different entities. Bottom line is we're very well recognized from a clinical perspective as being a top performer in Chicago, in the Chicago market. Have had a number of great kind of wins from a clinical perspective. As I mentioned, we're level one trauma centers, only four in Chicago, level three NICU, and some of the innovative things around the other two non-clinical programs I think I mentioned. We also have about 300 specialty physicians in the system. So this is what I spent my first 100 days doing. So I was charged with developing a new strategy and getting it board approved, and that happened in December. So it's still kind of very fresh. And a couple key tenets. One of them is really we want to be a more preferred provider of focused healthcare services. And the operative word being focused. Right now we have 41 specialties, but frankly, within 2 miles of my hospital, we have within Mount Sinai, we've got University of Illinois at Chicago, we've got Rush, we've got Cook County. These are all very good medical centers, and frankly, we need to become frankly more focused on things that we can really do a good job at, as opposed to being a diverse provider of everything. But that means we've got to partner more effectively with these other folks. So partnering is something that most health systems aren't great at, particularly with other health systems, because they're competitors. But the reality is, do we all need that many subspecialties within the 2 mile radius? The answer is no, and everybody suffers as a result of it. But it's very hard to change the way you operate, right? For a long time, health systems operated within their four walls. They tried to optimize and keep everybody in here. Now we're saying, let's share resources. If we've got a specialty that's 30% utilized or 50%, and so does our neighbor down the street, it makes sense for both parties and the patient, frankly, because the more volume a specialist does, the better outcomes they get, the better prices they can potentially offer as well. And so that's one of our key tenets. And so we're in the process of trying to figure out where do we want to focus. And for us, it's probably going to be chronic diseases, because in our community, in the south and west sides of Chicago, you have higher disease rates around diabetes, around COPD, around asthma. These really affect these lower income communities much more so than other areas. Number two is to be a more impactful provider of care management in the community. As I mentioned, we've got two leading, national leading entities around taking care of folks in our community, but right now they're pretty much 100% grant funded. So we've gotten a lot of really good success at getting grants from, different payers, different corporations, to really help improve the lives of those in our community. And that's a differentiator for us. We've been doing it for 20 years. What we need to do is put our own resources, Sinai Health Systems, in the game and really make those investments. But that means we have to get paid for that as well. So that means partnerships around keeping folks out of the hospital, working with other ACOs to say, listen, we'll take care of your psych patients because we've got a really good psych program, a really good diabetic program. So what we want to do is say, we'll make those investments in community health workers and other caregivers to really make an impact on the community, as opposed to just being grant funded. We'll continue the grant funding work, but we'll also do it on our own dime as well. That's the other really significant part of our strategy. And third is to be really a more efficient and I would say optimized health system. We operate largely in silos, and like many health systems, we're a system in name only, I think. And so we can do a much better job around IT, around processes, around referral, across a number of different fronts. And I think that's something that really will help improve the patient experience, which is something where we're frankly behind. We lack. We don't have the financial resources to have the billion-dollar facility. So what we've got to do is have a much better process by which patients want to come to us and stay within our system. So that's another significant part of our strategy. So again, it's fairly ambitious. It's meant to be about a 5-year strategy. It requires a lot of investments in IT, in clinical integration, in training, in development. It's in partnership, so it's a lot of work for us to do. So I'm excited about being part of this journey. As part of our strategy, we determined we've got a lot of gaps to fill, and we're frankly behind on this as well. So what I wanted to just share with you here is we've talked about a number of things that we think are opportunities for us as a system to improve patient care as well as caregiver interaction or collaboration. And what we're doing is we're going out into the tech community and saying with incubators, how can you guys help us with some of these problems? There are some things like, for example, an automated referral management process. Those applications, some of them already exist. There are companies that are already doing it. Perhaps you guys are doing it. But other ones are much more, we're saying, listen, can you guys develop custom programs for us, which is low cost for us, it's innovative for these startups, and allows them to pilot within our well-known system. So it's kind of a win-win on a number of fronts. So it could be patient reminder tools, it could be applications on communications or gaming to improve health. Automated referral management is a big deal for us. Real-time patient satisfaction is really critical. There's no point in getting something weeks later, hey, we can't even do anything about the encounter. So why not do something that's real time? Some systems are doing that, so we want to do something like that too. So we've got a number of things. This is just a small wish list of things that we're working on.